Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, welcome to this beautiful day after the storm. It's so lovely. Thank you. I think we're on plan D about by now. So my phone rang at 6:30 this morning. I thought, okay, I know what's coming. So, but it's a muddy mess at White Pines, but we're going to rejoice and worship God here. Thank you so much for coming. I invite you to silence your cell phones, please. This is a time of worship where our focus wants to be on God, and then as we serve one another, on each other. Children, you're invited to stay until Mr. Joe is finished with his part in the service, and then he will go out to Sunday school, and Ms. Shea will be with you as well. You could stay the whole time, because I've got some fun stories. Here at our church, we believe and we say and we proclaim, whoever you are or wherever you are in life's journey, you are welcome here. So if you came tired and weary, you will be refreshed. If you came jubilant, there will be time for dancing. And if you came in sorrow, you will be healed. This we proclaim. So we're going to begin with singing, and Daryl and the team are going to lead you in it all.
Does everyone have a song, a camp song sheet, booklet? Okay, so these are numbered for you. Number 17, it's not page, it's the number. Simple song, hallelujah, 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 praise ye the Lord. This was one of the favorite songs of the campers, or the Bible school kids. And so we're going to make sure you know it really well, and then we're going to see how energetic you are, because we have something to follow, okay? The band's going to give an introduction first. 1, 2, 3. We sing hallelujah, 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 and we stand up, praise ye the Lord. Then you sit down, hallelujah, the hallelujahs. You sit and you stand and the praise ye the Lord. After we go through it a couple times, we're gonna then do it faster. Okay, here we go. Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Stand,
praise ye the Lord,
and sit.
Yeah.
Okay, we did our calisthenics for the day. You may sit back there. You need a little rest, I can tell. A little slower song, how about that? Number two, he's got the whole world in his hands. And just imagine the beautiful lake out there and the beautiful cedar and pine trees that are around us. We can visualize it, can't we?
It's still pretty beautiful in America.
It is beautiful. One, two, three. Like a river, number 22. Number 22. And you know, sometimes when we sing this in church, I see people doing motions, and I never learned them myself, and I've always had busy at the keyboard, so I don't know them. Anybody know it well enough to come up and lead us? Laura, all right, yay! Do they need, they probably should stand for this, don't you think?
Yeah.
Let's stand up, okay. Follow Laura. Okay, so we got peace like a river, we got love like an ocean, and then we got joy like a fountain. All right, here's the band playing.
I've got peace like a river. I've got peace.
going to have a call to worship by a few people, and so you just have to listen. Let's breathe in deeply, settle ourselves from our active singing to listening and preparing our hearts for worship.
Friends, we gather together to worship God, and we stand in awe of creation.
We see God in the rising and the setting of the sun.
We see God in the moon and the stars of the night sky.
God's creative presence is all around us. We see God in the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, and the creatures of the sea.
From the flowers of the valley to the mountaintops in the sky,
we see God's beauty all over the earth.
Let us worship God, who is our creator and our sustainer.
So we're now going to hear a reading from Psalm. It's a paraphrase. So listen closely to the many references to creation.
Oh, sing to God a new song. Sing to the Majestic One, all the earth. Sing to the Holy One, bless God's name. Tell of the salvation from day to day. Declare God's glory among the nations. Shout Yahweh's marvelous works among all the peoples.
For great is God, and greatly to be praised. God is to be loved above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Creator made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before God. Strength and beauty are in God's sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Holy One, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to God's glory and strength. Ascribe to the Creator the glory due her name. Bring an offering and come into her courts. Worship God in holy array. Tremble before the Almighty, all the earth.
Say among the nations, our God reigns. Yea, the world is established. It shall never be moved. God will judge the people with equity. Let the heavens be glad. Let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all that fills it. Let the field exult and everything in it. Then shall all the trees of the wood sing for joy before God, before the Redeemer comes. The wise God comes to judge the earth. The world will be judged with righteousness and the peoples with God's truth.
What a powerful, powerful song that in creation we then have it ending up that the Creator is coming to judge. Some days I'd like God to judge right now, but we know God judged with love. Before we begin with our songs, I was remiss in talking about the connection cards. Did you get a connection card when you came in?
No.
No? Yes? There should be some in the pews. It looks like this. So I'd like you to fill it out today, put your name. If you're visiting with us, give us as much information as you'd like us to have, because this is going to be one of your gifts to put in the offering plate. And during the sermon time, I'm going to be asking you to write something if you have a pen or a pencil on the back. So please put today's date on it and your name, email, contact. Those of you who are members, if it hasn't changed, just put your name, and then we're going to use some space here. Also, if you have a prayer request, make sure you check if it's for pastor only or not. So just a little bit of housekeeping there. And now, yes.
There's none in these views.
Okay, Carl, where's the box with them? They'll get it. Okay, we'll pass them out. Yeah, we were hoping. That's the way it is when you go to Plan D. You get a little discombobulated. I mean, we're lucky we showed up here with clean clothes on. I mean, really. So we'll go ahead and sing. Well, Daryl, let's wait. They can get up, but let's pass these out so we're not interrupting your singing. Come on up, Fader in the box. Well,
so our next song is going to be in the songbook, number 18, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms of God, number 18. We'll wait just a moment.
They passed some out?
Yes.
Okay. Verses 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1 through 4.
Thank you.
So we come to a time that I often call confession. And sometimes people bristle at that a little bit and say, oh, must we have confession? Well, I need to confess. Especially today when we're thinking of God's creation, I realize that perhaps I use more resources than I need. And I don't leave enough for other people. And so I need to confess that. And sometimes in confession, it helps us think about changing and moving into a new path. Because when we say out loud those things that separate us from God, from others and creation, that's really what sin is. Anything that separates us from God, creation, and others. And I name it, then it kind of frees me to move forward into change. So I want us to just have a moment of silence while Daryl plays the flute and think about the things, the people, the words, the actions that separate us from God. Let us be in silence. Let us pray. Holy One, we have come to you bearing our hearts and our souls open, ready to change our ways. We want to use less water. We want to create less emissions in the air. We want to use less plastics. But some days it just seems not enough. And so we either give up, or we're apathetic and don't even think about it. Thank you for opening us to possibilities this morning to care for your creation. And now as we sit in silence, let's think of the joyful ways that creation ministers to us as we listen to the flute. Amen. Hear now the assurance of God's grace. We don't need to worry that God is frowning on us when we fail, for God's love is abundant and God's wisdom is abundant. Among us, we can find our way to heal creation. In this we can rejoice. I invite you to stand and sing Glory, Glory, Hallelujah. thrilled that we're going to meet at White Pines, and I have a sermon on creation and nature because that's my second home under the trees. So I'm going to, this is going to be a very different kind of sermon. It's going to be interactive, which is why I wanted you to have connection cards. And we're going to be chatting with each other a little bit. But I'm going to start with a story from John Muir's book, Book of Animals. And it also has beautiful illustrations in it. And this is the picture of the grasshopper. So if you can see it. I love John Muir. I could read his stuff every single day. And you will see that I've got another book of his, The Mountains of California, which I'm going to read. And I have another one at home. And then this book, The Hidden Life of Trees, I'm going to read from. And then our own Alan Horvath. Grasshopper. A queer fellow and a jolly fellow is the grasshopper. Up the mountains, he comes on excursions. How high, I don't know, but at least as far and high as Yosemite tourist. I was much interested with the hearty enjoyment of the one that danced and sang for me on Half Dome this afternoon. He seemed brimful of glad, hilarious energy manifested by springing into the air to a height of 20 or 30 feet. Then diving and springing up again and making a sharp musical rattle just as the lowest point in the descent was reached. Up and down a dozen times or so, he danced and sang, then alighted to rest, then up and at it again. The curves he described in the air in diving and rattling resembled those made by cords hanging loosely and attached at the same height at the ends, the loops nearly covering each other. Braver, hardier, keener, carefree enjoyment of life, I have never seen or heard in any creature, great or small. The life of this comic Redlegs, the mountain's merriest child, seems to be made up of pure condensed gaiety. The Douglas squirrel is the only living creature that I can compare him with in exuberant, rollicking, irrepressible jollity. Wonderful that these sublime creatures, mountains, are so loudly cheered and brightened by a creature so queer. Nature in him seems to be snapping her fingers in face of all the earthly dejection and melancholy with a boyish hip-hop hurrah. How the sound is made, I do not understand. When he is on the ground, he made not the slightest noise, nor when he was simply flying from place to place. But only when diving in curves, the motion seemed to be required for the sound. For the more vigorous the diving, the more energetic the corresponding outburst of jolly rattling. I tried to observe him closely while he was resting in the intervals of his performances, but he would not allow a near approach. Always getting his jumpy legs ready to spring for immediate flight and keeping his eyes on me. Mm-hmm. A fine sermon the little fellow danced for me on the dome, a likely place to look for sermons and stones, but not for grasshopper sermons, a large and imposing pulpit for so small a preacher. No danger of weakness in the knees of the world while nature can spring such a rattle as this. Even the bear did not express for me the mountain's wild health and strength and happiness, so telling as this comical little hopper. No cloud of care in his day, no winter of discontent in sight. To him, every day is a holiday, and when at length his sun sets, I fancy he will cuddle down on the forest floor and die like the leaves and flowers, and like them, leave no unsightly remains calling for a burial. John Muir, the grasshopper. Mm. So these are marvelous. It was hard for me to choose just one to read to you today. But the little things in life are all around us. If we pause to see them, we will be blessed. So I was going to ask you today, if we were at White Pines, why do we worship at White Pines? So let's have a popcorn-style conversation. And some of you tell me, why do you think once a year we carry everything up there and keyboards and food and everything and go up there? Why do you think we do that?
so beautiful.
Beautiful.
Well, the nature and the animals really bring us back to what God is in our hearts and souls.
Thank you. Yes, the nature brings us back to God's heart and soul.
It's usually cooler than down here.
Usually cooler than down here.
God's gift.
Water, God's gift.
Appreciating
what God gave us. So sometimes stepping outside of this beautiful sanctuary, as lovely as it is, and going somewhere different invites us to think differently. I think we do it because of tradition. When I came here, you always went to White Pines once a year, so we go to White Pines. We also do it because it's fun. We can swim up there, we can boat up there, we can fish up there. We also baptize people up there, so it's a great time for me to gather people who want to be baptized. And also just to do something different. You know, not all change is bad. So sometimes getting us out of our stayed place right here is a good thing. Would we dare to believe that we do it to see God in nature, I think, and to live in creation and learn from it? So there's another book I have called The Hidden Life of Trees. I've referred this to you many times. Now, some people are not in love with it as much as I am. But the author believes that there's a whole web of life, of communicating in the trees. I totally, totally believe it. And I sit under the trees to get my comfort and to get my naps. And so one of the chapters, he talks about the beech forest. And he explains about the community. He says, beech forest is more productive when the trees are packed together. Now, if you've ever seen a beech forest, and you can see one driving up over the pass to get to Mono Lake, there's a whole area of beech that's magnificent. They are really tight together, and you're thinking, well, they don't have any room. How are they going to get sun? How are they going to get water? But a clear annual increase in biomass above all wood is proof of the health of the forest throng. And this author says this: when trees grow together, nutrients and water can be optimally divided among them so that each tree can grow into the best tree it can be. Wow, what a theological statement for the church. I mean, think about it. Instead of us sitting here and thinking, oh, I'm getting crowded by somebody else's ideas and somebody's thoughts. No, you're close enough to someone so that their roots and their theology and their love, even their sorrow, can help you grow. And I just think that is one of the most beautiful pictures of the church. If you help individual trees by getting rid of their supposed competition, the remaining trees are bereft. They send messages out their neighbors in vain, but nothing remains but stumps. So this author, who is an expert on trees, says it's better to be clumped together. Boy, do we need that in our day and age. And then, what a powerful lesson. So I'd like you to now turn to the person next to you or in your pew and talk about what ways do you share your nutrients or your gifts or your branches or your water with someone else. And please, we have a few rules. You only get to talk for like a minute and a half. Each person has to take a turn. I've learned in this congregation that some of us like to talk for 20 minutes. So, and in Assisi, one of the practices I'm learning is that if I've talked for 5 minutes, that means it's not my turn anymore. So we're not even going to take 5 minutes. Just a phrase or two, or what are the nutrients, gifts that you share with other people? And it could be here, it could be in your life. So go ahead, I'll give you, let's see, there's the most we have in any pew is 4. So I'll give 6 minutes. So let's go. And you guys.
Thank you.
One more minute, so make sure everyone's had a chance to talk. Did you find your gifts? Were there surprises? Not too much. Yes? Yes. So now we're going to talk about winds. So in addition to gifts, we have winds and storms like we did last night. And what's really interesting is I had prepared this way before the storms and before the hurricane was even predicted. But there are storms which represent adversity. And so in this book of John Muir, The Mountains of California, he talks about a windstorm in the forest. The mountain winds, like the dew and rain, sunshine and snow, are measured and bestowed with love on the forest to develop their strength and beauty. However restricted the scope of other forest influences, that of the winds is universal. The snow bends and trims the upper forest every winter. The lightning strikes a single tree here and there, while avalanches mow down 1,000 at a swoop, as a gardener trims out a bed of flowers. But the winds go to every tree, fingering every leaf and branch and fir and bole. Not one is forgotten. The mountain pine towering with outstretched arms on the rugged buttresses of the icy peaks, the lowliest and most retiring tenant of the dells. They seek and find them all, caressing them tenderly, bending them in lusty exercise, stimulating their growth, plucking off a leaf or limb as required, or removing an entire tree or grove, now whispering and cooing through the branches like a sleepy child, now roaring like the ocean. The winds blessing the forest the winds, with ineffable beauty and harmony as the sure result. Well, if you're like me, sometimes those winds don't sound like a cooing baby. They're more like a roar. And almost every day, about 4 o'clock in our neighborhood in Arnold, where we live, there's a wind that comes through, and it sounds like the ocean. When I lie on the deck looking up at the pine trees and hear it, it feels as if I'm at the ocean. But the debris that it leaves behind is a mess, always cleaning up on my hands and knees, cleaning out the debris from my rock garden. But Muir says when the storm is over and we behold the same forest tranquil again, towering fresh and unscathed in erect majesty, and consider what centuries of storms have fallen upon them since they were first planted. Hail to break the tender seedlings, lightning to scorch and shadow, snows, winds, avalanches to crush and overwhelm. While the manifest result of all this wild storm culture is the glorious perfection we behold, then faith in nature's forestry is established, and we cease to deplore the violence of her most destructive gales or of any other storm implement whatsoever. How is that like the church? Well, we are really rocked and swayed by the winds of hate, by the winds of not taking care of the earth. And so much happens that we could say, oh, we don't want it, it's terrible. But John says that the winds touch each person. Each one of you, I know, because I know almost all of you, not quite, have had some tragedies in your life, have had some serious, tough, hard times. Those gales have come knocking you down. But when the storm is done, John says, the forest is then beautiful, and we have faith in the storm. For me, the only way I can have faith in the storm is to have faith in God and faith in the Christian community. That when I'm swaying and wished all about, somebody says, it's okay, I've got you. That phrase is really big now, I've got you, or you've got this, is another one that people sent to me when I was going through cancer treatment. You've got this. And sometimes I would look at the little heart shape that had that you've got this in it, and I'd say, it doesn't feel like I've got it when I'm throwing up. But I knew people were praying. In the midst of the storm, people were praying. So I'd like you to get out your connection card, and I'd like you to write one thing that either you personally or the storm or the church is going through as a storm. One thing of a storm you're experiencing. And I'm going to have you put those in the offering plate, then I will pray for them on Tuesday, for the storm either in your life or a storm that you feel the church is going through. And I'll give you just a minute or two to do that. Does anybody need one? I think we have. Thank you, Faye. Thank you for doing that. And when the offering plates go around, we will put those in. You know, today is a perfect example of how we've been battered by the storm, But we came together in a beautiful fashion, and we're going to have a lovely meal together. And so when you're tempted to lose hope in your storm this week, I hope you'll remember that we came together in the midst of it. And I'm going to close this sermon part with another little story. This book is Tales of the Great Creator by Alan Horvath. And Alan is one of our members. And it has beautiful illustrations in it. And when we went camping 2 years ago, I don't know if you did this last year, we had him read some to us. And it was just marvelous. The best thing is to read the whole book from beginning to end, because you get the story as it goes. But I'm reading a very short one, How the Bat Came to Be. When the great creator had made the mountains, he called down to the mice in the meadow. Little one, he said, now that you live in the mountains, it will be cold in the winter. Your nice fur coats will keep you warm, but in the winter, everything will be covered in snow. Be sure and gather up lots of seeds and nuts now while it is warm, so you will have plenty to eat all winter. So all the mice in the meadow set about gathering up extra food and storing it safely in their underground nest. But one little mouse said to himself, I know the birds had to fly far to the north to get these seeds, and the plants they brought back are so very wonderful. I will store up just a little extra, and in the spring, I will still have seeds to plant so the flowers will grow again. And so he did. All summer long, when the other mice made 10 trips a day to gather seeds, he made 11. And all winter long, when the other mice ate 3 thimbles a day of seed, he ate only 2. So when spring came, he had a great store of seed. One bright sunny day, when the snow had all melted and the ground was soft and damp, the little mouse set out to plant his seed. From one corner of the meadow to the other he went, digging little holes with his paws and carefully planting his seeds. As he was scurrying back and forth from the nest, the great creator looked down and saw him. Little one, called the great creator, what are you doing? The little mouse was a bit embarrassed to be addressed directly, but stopping his work, he looked up respectfully and said, oh, sir, I know how far the birds had to go to get these plants, so I saved some seed to replant our lovely meadow. How wonderful, exclaimed the great creator. But did you not trust me to take care of you? Look about you. The plants have reseeded themselves and are already starting to come up. Now the little mouse was really embarrassed. He hid his little face in his paws and sobbed, oh, sir, I did not mean any disrespect. I just love our meadow plants so much that I had to save some. The great creator reached down and gently picked up the little mouse in his hand. Bringing him right to the end of his nose, he whispered, do not worry, little one. You have pleased me greatly. Because of what you did, I shall give all mice pouches in their cheeks so they can carry more seed than they need. And they shall plant these seeds in every nest and burrow they did. So my flowers will spread far and wide. But now for you, little one, can I grant you some special wish? The little mouse spoke up as quick as can be. Oh, yes, sir, I want to fly like the birds. The great creator had not expected this answer, and he was visibly wondering just how he would grant it. But little one, he said, you already have fur and a tail, while all the birds have feathers. How can I make you into a flying creature now? I do not know, sir, answered the mouse, but since you can make such beautiful mountains, surely you can make me fly. It was hard to argue with that. So the great creator thought and thought. Finally, he said, little one, if you will climb up high and hold on tight with your back feet, and if you will stay that way all day long, when nighttime comes, you shall be able to fly. Well, the highest thing in the meadow was a giant old willow bush. So the little mouse climbed up to its thick branches and hung on by his back feet. After a while, he fell asleep. Many hours later, just as the moon was coming up, the little mouse awoke. And much to his delight, he had grown the most wondrous soft wings. Letting go of the branch, he flew. Oh, great creator, he called out. Look at me fly. Oh, thank you, thank you, thank you. Oh, thank you, replied the great creator, for with your help, I have made bats. Mm-hmm. And so he had. So these books are for sale. You can buy them on Amazon, or you can buy them from Adam or Bath. But what a lovely creation. I could literally preach a sermon on a piece of creation every day for 3 solid years, I tell you. But what we learned from creation today is that we can trust the community to be together, and we can also trust God when the winds and the storms come in our life. And actually, the last story, I'll let you draw your own conclusion somewhat, but I think it's that we could ask God for most unusual gifts. That we don't have to think inside the box. We can begin to think, what might I do? God, I want to fly. Well, we'll see if I made it to a bed. Amen. So I invite you now to, we're going to sing Kumbaya. It's number 4 in your little booklet. Creator, we are indeed blessed with this beautiful world. For the trees, the water, the mountains, even the storms. We thank you for the people whom we love and whom love us. We especially are grateful that we could come together today to share our joys and our sorrows. You are such a wonderful healing God, and so we call on you this day to heal those who are suffering. We pray for Diane, for Hillary, for Lynn, for Angela. We pray for the family of Barbara Peterson as they grieve and mourn her death. We ask your mercy on those who are sick, and may we be present to help them through their tough times. We do thank you for the teachers as school started this week, and we ask you to be with families and parents. We know that changes in the seasons and changes in activities can throw havoc in people's lives. bring calm and joy and mercy. We pray for those who come to us each week needing a shelter or food or gas. We ask that we might continue to be a blessing to them. We thank you for the people who come to our blessing box, and we know that there seems to be a lot of people needing food these days. We are so grateful that we can be the answer to their prayers. We also come to you, God, eager to conserve and save our earth. Show us new ways that we might take care of it and not use more than we need. Thank you for all the gifts that have been present here this morning, those that we see and those that we don't see. We ask you to be in our hearts and soften us that we might be tender when the world is full of hate. We pray for those who are displaced from the fire in Maui. How tragic it is, we know many of our own folk have experienced the same loss. Show us the way how we might be of service to them. We pray too for mercy as our governments work together to bring peace. We ask that you would give wisdom and guidance and that they might listen to you and to others instead of being violent or self-serving. We thank you for the music that we've had today and participated in to lift our spirits and to sing our praise to you. We thank you for Jesus, who always reached out to those in need. And we pray now the prayer he taught us, and I invite you to say it in any way you know it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And do not let us fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We now have the offering, and Laura will lead us in it.
As evident through all of creation, God has given freely to us. Let us continue to worship through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. You may place your connection cards in the plates at this time. Will the ushers please come forward? There they are. God, we know that you aren't in need of anything we have to offer. However, You desire for us to serve you in every aspect of our lives. We pray that this offering was not a meaningless ritual, but a true act of worship. Bless these offerings and guide us as we seek to use them to serve you in all of creation. Amen.
Amen.
For our sending hymn, we are going to sing number 19. Bind us together, Lord, bind us together. We will just sing the chorus, which will be the first two lines.
Friends, go sleep beneath a tree. Roll around in the dirt. Dip your fingers and your feet in the water and see how good God is. And then go tell somebody about it. Amen.
Amen.
A few announcements before our postlude song. Someone is going to be selling Habitat tickets, Pat Lamont. And they are raffle tickets, yes, for $20. To Cabo San Lucas, and Daryl and I won it a couple years ago. It is fantastic, and the money goes to help build houses. Habitat is hoping to build and planning. We have land to build 107 houses in Angels Camp. We just need some infrastructure money, so your money will go to a very good cause. The Peddler's Fair is this Friday and Saturday. If you want to sell your stuff, because it's time to clean out. Start thinking about getting rid of all that stuff because you don't want your kids to have to go through it when you're dead. I can tell you. I have driven by three houses this week and young people are out there cleaning stuff that's been there for 50 years. Don't do it. Get rid of it. Make some money, and if you don't want the money, give it to the blessing box. But anyway, Friday and Saturday, please come and buy or sell things. Habitat, we talked about. My days off this week, hopefully, are going to be Monday and Friday. So if you call me on those days, I will not answer, or I try not to answer the email. If it's an emergency, call Jenny at the office and she'll get a hold of me. I mean, if you are in crisis, excuse me, please call. Also, Jenny's going to have a new schedule change, and she's going to be out of the office on Wednesdays. She has her school, her daughter has a school problem, not a problem really, but a change. So I'll be in on Wednesdays when I'm not out visiting with you. But just know you can call on Wednesdays and you'll either get me or leave a message or call my cell phone because I will be available. Anything else that I forgot that is pressing that anybody knows about? Marcy.
Lasagna loaf, food drive at the Peddler's Fair, and also we now have an Amazon wish list published.
Okay, so Lasagna Love is one of our partners in ministry to make lasagna for those who need food. So there are lists. If we don't have them today, Marcy's going to have them on her table, and you can bring items in and pick up the sheet, or you can just donate money as well. Excuse me. I think that's about it. So we're going to have the postlude, and then we're going to eat.
All right. So join us in singing number 14. I'll fly away. You may stand if you would like.